Good morning, Dan.
Hi, how you doing?
This is our first ever Saturday morning program. You and I grew up sitting in your work truck sometimes on Saturdays listening to car talk. I have very fond memories of that. So I thought we'd do a little father-daughter HVAC shop talk on Saturday mornings. I just wanted to use these Saturday morning shows as when, like, a designated time where subscribers can ask random HVAC questions. You have been a HVAC technician since 1979, and you've basically seen it all. So I'm wondering if we can ever stump you. Today I have a few questions for you today, all coming from, you know, subscriber questions on our YouTube channel. I will have timestamps down below if somebody wants to jump to a particular question and hear your answer.
Okay, and full disclosure, because this is a new format, you gave me the questions last night. So I did last night.
First question. Mm-hmm. This viewer was watching our video about a heat pump running all the time and asked us this. Heat pump is running, but the central AC is not working when he switches it from basically heating to cooling. The thermostat says that it's running, but the temperature just keeps going up. Cooling is working normally. What could be wrong?
And so we're having to be a detective here. I'm going to have to read between a few lines as well. The first part of it was the central AC is not working. And then later he says cooling is working normally. So those seem to contradict each other.
Right.
However, without getting too technical on this one, because it could be several things, but with a heat pump, we have a device called a reversing valve. And it's kind of a part that an air conditioner doesn't have. And it's really what makes a heat pump a heat pump. And this reversing valve literally reverses the flow of refrigerant through the circuit. In the cooling mode, it flows in one particular direction. In the heating mode, it flows in the opposite direction. And the entire question is kind of referring to the operation of this reversing valve. As far as the compressor running and fan motors running, things like that, those are both the same for both the heating and the cooling operation. This reversing valve is what dictates, is it actually putting warm air in the house or is it putting cool air in the house? One of the two. And it all revolves around that. So it could be a number of things. It could be a stuck reversing valve where it's not shifting gears. And so I've got it calling for cooling, but my house keeps getting warmer. See, technically the heat pump is still in the heating mode, but the thermostat is telling it to go. It's going to be something along that lines. Now, whether it's a mechanical problem with the reversing valve, meaning it's physically stuck, it can't move, it's not doing what it's supposed to, or is it a control? Is the reversing valve being told to shift one way and then the other way? You know, it's all a function of the thermostat and the connecting wiring. I'm not going to condemn the reversing valve. Not that they don't fail, but it's less likely. It's more likely something is not wired properly with the thermostat, and it's going to revolve around the B or the O terminal, depending on the brand of air conditioner or heat pump that you have. I'm going to say it's probably a miswiring, or it could even be a misconfiguration of the thermostat itself. So I really don't have too many more details other than that, but I hope that helps. The problem is around the reversing valve. I really don't think the reversing valve is probably anything wrong with it. It's going to be more of a control wiring problem with the thermostat. Okay. So that gives you enough, as a homeowner, enough information. And if you're talking to a technician, I should be hearing that kind of conversation.
Next question for you, or this question came off of our video that was on heat pump versus air conditioner. I'm quite convinced that I should get a heat pump instead of an air conditioner. You mentioned that the price difference would be 10-15% more for a heat pump. However, the two quotes I've gotten are 50-70% more, comparing the same brand and tonnage. These quotes include installation. Why so expensive? Your insight would be appreciated.
That is difficult for me to comment because different parts of the country, what are we talking about? I really don't know. There's a lot of particulars I don't know. However, we're talking about just specifically the difference in price if I were to put in a heat pump system versus an air conditioning system. And now I'm going to assume that you have a gas backup, you're using a gas furnace. So here in the Midwest, I'm in the Midwest, and we call this a dual fuel system where I actually have a gas furnace as part of the same system. I can have an air conditioner or I can have a heat pump. Heat pump looks just like the air conditioner, sits out in the yard, but has the capability of heating my house. And so I could use the electric heat pump if utility rates were spiking or being affected, like here what this last winter, natural gas prices have been high. So that's what we're talking about. I'm assuming you have gas as a primary heat source. There, you know, a system like that, I'm going to just speak in very, very general terms. 1,000 to 2 difference going, same system, going from an air conditioner to a heat pump. It used to be one of the major expenses, or a big part of it, the difficulty in putting them in was being able to pull enough wires to your thermostat. You know, we deal in existing homes. A lot of times there was not enough wires in the wall, and we would spend several hours pulling wire through walls or up through attics, things like that. Today now we have Wi-Fi thermostats and communicating thermostats where we don't need to pull wires for them anymore. And so that really has made them much easier. Now those controls are not inexpensive, but it requires no more labor to put them in than just changing out a regular thermostat. So I hope that helps. You know, $1,000 to $2,000, you know, you're talking in percentages of this 50 to 70%. Well, that's huge.
Yeah.
And so I don't know what's going on. Yeah, that doesn't sound right.
It sounded weird to me, but also, I mean, we made that video probably 2 years ago now. I mean, I don't know what kind of crazy things are going on in certain areas of the country with pricing.
And understand, I'm personally not involved in pricing equipment today, so that's just a general range where I think it probably ought to fall. And I will say that we need to fall within that range for it to really be a good investment for you. You know, if it's any more than that, I can't imagine the difference between your electric rates and your gas rates that it's going to be a viable alternative, right? You know, but that seemed like a pretty big spread.
Okay, so this next question is on zoning. Viewer watched our video walking through, I think it was on the video where you put the zoning in my house and we were explaining how it works. So this viewer says, I want to do this in my home, but I was concerned about the back pressure with the closed damper. What are your thoughts?
Yeah. Well, and just so everyone's on the same page, zoning is where we take a home where most people have one furnace, one air conditioner, one duct system servicing the entire house, and one thermostat. Whenever that thermostat says we need heat or need cool, it runs and it's heating and cooling the entire house. And what zoning does is we are able to cut your home into different zones. Very common one, like what we did at your house, was we made the main living area floor as zone, and the second floor, which had all the bedrooms in it, as a second zone. So we had two zones. We were able to split the upstairs and downstairs. Now, the question they're asking is, gee, if I put zone dampers in the ductwork, I'm literally cutting off half of my ductwork. You know, is that going to be a problem? I think that's what he's referring to by...
He was asking about back draft.
Back pressure.
Or back pressure.
I'm assuming he's talking about the static pressure in the ductwork. And that is a concern. However, we're using that static pressure to force air into parts of the home that we've never been able to really get a substantial amount of air. So that's one, is we actually use that back pressure. Now, we can't let it get too high or it will affect the blower of the furnace. Now, we usually install variable drive motors in the furnace. You know, at your house, Andrea, we replaced it with an aftermarket motor that was a variable drive motor. It is capable of pushing against higher static pressures than a regular PSC motor is, you know, a typical multi-speed blower motor. One is we do put in motors that can handle that higher static pressure, as well as we will put in, when needed, a what we call a bypass damper that will alleviate that excess pressure in the ductwork. So if the static pressure in the supply duct starts getting too high, we will open a damper and relieve that pressure by dumping some of that supply air back into the return air. just to keep the static pressure in a workable range. So yes, it is a concern, but when you do it properly, you make allowances for that. And like I said, we actually use that raised static pressure to deliver air where a lot of times, you know, homeowners couldn't really feel that there was much air volume coming out of certain registers. So
this question was, I posted a little short video on Xavier washing out an air conditioner unit. And I mentioned to him, I'm like, hey, every time I follow one of you guys along, there's always a very set routine on how you do an air conditioner maintenance. I notice they always wash it out before they check the refrigerant. And so I asked him, hey, why do you do that? And he says, well, you know, you just want to get the proper, you're not going to get a proper reading if it's clogged up. Okay, so this question says, typically a dirty condenser raises the pressure, so you would appear to have more, not less refrigerant. Please ask Raymond to confirm or refute this. I think Xavier might have said, you don't have enough refrigerant or something like that. So.
And Xavier was correct. You're both correct. Yes, when you have a dirty outdoor coil, it can cause the system run a higher head pressure, higher pressures. You would tend to equate with more refrigerant in the system. However, if we have a, depending on the type of metering device we have on the indoor coil, and if we had an instance, we have one of two metering devices. These are flow devices for the refrigerant on the indoor coil. One is a thermal expansion valve, and it works a certain way, but one of the most common is having a piston or fixed restrictor. So here we are, we're running a high head pressure because we have a dirty coil, causes the head pressure to go higher, which pushes more refrigerant through that fixed restrictor. And it can actually make, I'm going to get too technical here, but he was asking for a technical explanation. It causes the superheat to go up because we're pushing more refrigerant through that coil. So you can be in a situation, and I always love these kinds of calls, and I'll explain why, but I always love these kinds of calls where, you know, I'm checking an air conditioner and just looking at the surface, the refrigerant charge looks kind of okay. And however, I'm also looking at it and I know that you have a very dirty condenser coil, but I'm kind of looking at it and it's kind of a normal range as far as the gauges and this superheat and all those technical things go. And what was always interesting is you could turn the unit off and do a thorough washdown of that coil. Now I'm operating with a clean coil. And guess what happens to all the pressures? They go down and the amount of refrigerant that's pushing through that coil inside goes down. And now my superheat goes up. And after I let the outdoor coil warm up a little bit, I realized this thing is short of refrigerant. Well, wait a minute. With the dirty coil, it was operating perfectly fine. And so I always felt very good about servicing an air conditioner when it was like that, because I know with confidence, I can talk to the homeowner. For one, we've got our unit running short of refrigerant, which makes it very inefficient. And we've got a dirty coil, which also makes it very inefficient. This thing is operating so inefficient and using so much electricity. I'm going to be able to leave this unit and it's going to be operating so much better. I can tell them with confidence, you won't believe how good this air conditioner is going to work now, because it has been operating in such a state where it, on initial check, it really wasn't that bad. It really didn't look that bad, but actually it was very bad. So yes, that dirty outdoor coil can actually hide a unit that is running short of refrigerant.
Just from a practical standpoint, I'm like, doesn't it always make sense to clean it out first just so that you have an accurate reading?
Well,
no matter if it's showing that it's too high or low.
When we're training technicians and doing our in-house training, you cannot know whether that refrigerant charge is correct until you wash it out. You have to know that both the indoor coil and the outdoor coil are clean before you can know anything about the refrigerant charge.
Right. Okay. I thought it was definitely an interesting question. Yeah. So this question came from a furnace noise type video where we're discussing different reasons why your furnace might make a noise. My gas furnace and hot water heater are in the attic. I hear a high-pitched whistle sound in the living room ceiling at 3 a.m. My furnace has been off since 10 p.m. No hot water has been used for hours. There is no AC. Access to attic is located in the middle of the house near the furnace and water heater. When I open the access door, I hear no sound, but in the living room, it's loud. Mm-hmm. I thought, if I'm going to stump you, this is a pretty good one. So I was very concerned about
that. And that's why I love getting questions like this for a couple of reasons. One is,
it's a mystery.
I'm tracking with them when they're talking about my furnace is in the attic. You know, mm-hmm. Okay. So is my hot water heater. Not around here.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm almost even thinking, have I ever seen a water heater? I have, only a couple, just very few. So I would love to know where this homeowner is. Yeah, this was an interesting one. So they just have heat only, and their water heater and their furnace are up in the attic, and late at night, they'll hear a whistling sound.
3 a.m.
And I'm thinking about, and yet when they stick their head up in the attic, they don't hear it. So I'm thinking about this, and the furnace and air conditioner haven't been used in quite some time, you know, a number of hours, and they're hearing this noise. I'm going to say it has nothing to do with the furnace and air conditioner. Have you ever had the smoke alarm do the beeping thing?
Mm-hmm.
You know, when it needs a battery? I didn't realize, but like my house here, I must have 10 or 12 detectors in my house.
Mm-hmm.
Now, which one is making the noise? I mean, it is nearly impossible,
right.
You know, to just get that whistle that I'm calling it a whistle, but that beeping, I'm wondering if it's something like that. And they're just, you know, by not hearing it from up when you put your head in the attic, it's not. So I'm going to say it's not coming from the attic. If they're not hearing it up in the, when they stick their head up there.
Right. And
that tells me that's not the direction to go to figure out what
they say. I hear a high-pitched whistle sound in the living room ceiling.
Mm-hmm.
At 3 a.m., but the furnace is off, the hot water heater is off. So if they're not running, how could they be making?
Yeah, I'm saying it's not, I don't think the noise is coming from the attic.
Right.
And so I would check the alarms. That really is, now I don't know if I would call it a, how did they describe it? They called it a...
A high-pitched whistle.
A high-pitched whistle.
And what threw me off too is that it keeps happening at the same time, because I was thinking, well, you know, that's when the house is the quietest.
Yeah.
Like maybe it's happening more often throughout the day, but you don't notice it.
Because in the middle of the night, high pitched sounds, it's hard to, did it come from this direction or that direction, you know,
right.
That kind of thing. I would investigate more downstairs. I'm ruling out the attic.
Can you think of anything like wiring wise that would be like up in the ceiling?
No, other than, you know, I don't know if you've got a security alarm, something, you know, is there something that I've even seen them put things that are wired to the security alarm in the duct system. It spreads the sound throughout the house. But I'm saying it's not in the attic. I'm expand your search downstairs.
Okay. Yeah, that was a curious one. All right. Well, that's all the questions I have.
Let us know when you find out.
For all these questions, I hope everybody lets us know if we're on the right track. Thank you very much, Dad. And I will encourage anybody that if they have any other heating and air conditioning questions, we're going to have a show like this every Saturday morning now. So leave your questions below and we'll ask Raymond on our next episode.
I got registered for a driving experience. It only cost me $25.
Mm-hmm.
I get 2 hours at the BMW test track driving their car.
Cool.
A professional driver is going to take you on hot laps that will thrill you.
That's only $20.
You're going to take a Mini off-road, because see, they make a Mini that's all-wheel drive now. So you can take a Mini off, you're going to take one off road, you're going to run an autocross, you know, with the little, like what you see out in the parking lot, you know, so yeah, for $20.
Dad, I don't know if I've heard of a better retirement job for you than being one of those drivers that takes people out
exactly. And
on the off-road adventure.